Hello everyone, hope you are doing well. Welcome back to my channel again. In this video, we are going to talk about how you can build or how you can do a low-level design of a parking lot problem. I would request you to go through the complete video of this so that you get the complete idea of the parking lot system design. I have discussed many things like what all I have done, my improvements, further enhancements. So, you know, just don't skip in between and try to get the complete idea. So let's start with the problem first. So the problem statement, as it says, it's for the parking lot, but the specific problem is that there's a parking lot and at any time there can be n cars that can be parked in the parking lot, and each car will be parked in single slot, and the slots are defined as like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So slots, each slot has a number, and parking lot has n slots, so it can accommodate n cars at a time, right? And whenever someone wants to enter a parking lot, they will be assigned a ticket at the entry, and each of the car which enters the parking lot will be identified by a registration number and a color, and each car which comes will be allotted a single slot, whichever is available. I'll just tell you like how the slot will be picked, but one slot will be allotted to the car, and three details, registration number, color, and the slot number will be saved in the system, and the slot number will also be given to the car, so the car can park itself, or the user can park its car to the given slot, right? Now, how the slot will be given? So the customer should be allotted the slot which is very nearer to the entry. What does that mean is like, let's say the slot number starts from 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on up to N. So the first slot that is given to the first customer is should be slot number 1. And then for the second customer, slot number 2. And then for the third customer, slot number 3 and so on. So whichever slot is free and is nearer to the entry is the one which is given first to the customer. So it's like natural ordering. So the slot numbers are allotted in a natural ordering way. And similarly, when the customer exits the parking lot, the slot becomes free, right? So these are the basic requirements of a parking lot. There are some additional requirements which says that we have to give all the registration numbers of all the cars for a particular color. So we will give in a color in the input, and we have to return all the cars with that given registration number. We'll be given a color in the input, and we have to give registration number of all the cars which are parked inside the parking lot for and they have that particular color. Another requirement is we'll have to give a slot number for a given registration number. So we'll get a registration number as the input, and we'll return slot number. Again, there's a third requirement, which is like for a particular color, we'll have to give all the slots which have that particular color of car parked. So these are the requirements for the parking lot, and how the interaction will happen with the system, this is also defined over here. So there are two ways. One way is via file input, and another way is via interactive mode via command line. So in the file input, we'll be given commands via input in the file. So file will have all the list of commands, and we'll be given that file as an input. Maybe file name we'll get, and we'll have to read that file and parse each of the commands one by one, and then perform the action as per that. And another option we'll be using interactive mode, and in that mode we'll be taking each of the command one by one, and we'll be performing output as per that. So let's take an example. So for example, for the interactive mode, these are the commands which we have given as an example. So let's say the first command which we get is like create parking lot. So it creates the parking lot with the 6 slots. So this is the interactive mode. So the command is given directly at the command line. So we'll get this command, and we'll have to create a parking lot with the 6 slots. The next command that we get is, let's say, parking a car. So park car number and the color. So we have to park this particular car with this given number, with this color, in a slot. So this is a second command, like park. First command was create parking lot. Let's say same command is given again for a different car. So let's say similarly we park 6 cars in the parking lot. Now another command is like, say, leave says like leave gets a slot number. So we have to remove the car from the particular slot number when the leave command is issued, so that particular slot will become free. Another command is status. So in the status, we have to give the status of all the slots in the parking lot. Not actually all the slots, but the occupied slots in the parking lot. So for example, when the status is taken at this point of time, so we'll have to give all the all the cars which are parked inside the parking lot. So we have like 4 cars, 5 cars, because car number 4 left. So only 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6 are parked. So we have to give all the registration number and color of those cars. Then we again get, let's say, park car. So we park the car in the slot number 4. and then we again try to park another car. So slot, if the slot, if there is no slots free, like all the parking is full, so we'll just return parking is full. Then as I saw, like these are three requirements. So so for these three requirements also there are commands. So for example, for getting registration numbers of all the cars with a given color, we'll get a color in the input and we'll have to give all the cars with that particular color. So for example, for white you can say like 1, 2 and the car number 4 which we just parked are the three colors, are the three cars. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 9, 9, 9, 3, 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 9, 9, 9, 3, 3 are the cars which are given as output. Similarly, when we have to give as a slot numbers for a given color, so we'll have to find slot numbers like 1, 2, and 4 are the slot numbers, so we'll return that. Now we now there's a different command for slot number for a given registration number. So we'll get the car registration number in the input. So the car registration number is this and the slot number is 6, so we'll return 6 over here. If we get a if we have to give a slot number for a registration number and the registration number is not found, then we will have to return not found. So these are the commands which are given to us, and exit is a special command for the interactive mode, because in interactive mode the command the system is running or the program is running, so you need some way to exit from the program. So there is a special command on when we enter exit, we'll just complete or we'll just close the program or run, what we'll just close the process. So these are commands in the interactive mode. Similarly, the same commands are issued in the file mode also, but the only difference is the way the input is given. In the file mode, we'll get the list of commands as a content of file, and we'll return the output as the is on the STD out, or maybe we could have also written on files, but we'll write the output on the STD out. So this is the problem given to us. So we'll have to create a parking lot. So let's go through the solution that I wrote for them. So This is the set of files which I created. So I have divided my files into 4 or 5 packages. One is commands, exceptions, mode, model, service, and validators. Then there are some unit tests which I written. So this part has all the unit tests. Now for the overall overview, so this is the main function from where the program execution starts. This is the output printer. This class is particularly used for outputting anything to the user. So whenever we want to output something to the user, we'll use this command. Right now it just use standard output, but tomorrow if you want to change it to some other output, maybe write to a file or maybe send to the network, you can just change the implementation and get the new output behavior instead of changing it everywhere in the program. So that's why I just created this, abstracted out the output part in a different class. Then there's a commands package. It has all the commands. We'll go through each one of them later on, but the whole idea is like each of the command is divided into different class. So each particular command is executed by one class. So for example, this is for exit command, this is for leave command, this is for status command, and so on. So each of the command is being handled by a different class. Then I have a package for exception. So this has all the exceptions which I created. Like invalid slot, if the slot is invalid, and no free slot. So these are exceptions which I created. Then there are different classes for modes. So I had an interface for a mode, and there are two types of modes, file mode and interactive mode, as we saw in the problem. So I created two modes, I created classes for the two modes. And then there is something called parking strategy, we'll come to it. And then there are model classes, and then there is a parking lot service, which is the main service which will be handling our parking lot. And these are some validators, right? So let's start with the main function. So the main function, we start with the output printer because we have to output to the user, right? So we first create an output printer, and then we also create a parking lot service, because that's the core heart of the solution that we have, because everything will be handled by parking lot service. So we create an object of it, and then there is something called commands executor factory. So command executor factory will create all the commands, or will provide us commands for a particular input given to a command executor for the input given to us. So and then it will be executing the command. So for execution of the command, it needs parking lot service, so that's why we have given as input to it. We'll come into detail of this particular thing later on. Then the main thing starts actually from here. Until there, these were the only initializations. Now we have the actual execution. So we first of all check what's the mode, like is the interactive mode or if it is a file mode. So interactive mode or file mode are actually distinguished by whether we get the file, the name as the input from the command line. If there is a file name in the input, then it is called as file mode. If there is no input in the command line, then it is simply an interactive mode. And if the file name, if there is something else also with the file input, then that's a unknown mode for us, and that's why we throw invalid mode exception over there. So depending on the mode, we initialize the object. I mean, if it's a interactive mode, we'll initialize interactive mode. If it's a file mode, we will initialize file mode. And these modes will take the executor factory and output printer. You will see like why do we need to pass all these two things when we go into detail of these. And then once we initialize this, we'll have to process. Like we'll start processing like for file mode also and for interactive mode also. And these both these modes are actually confirmed to mode class. So for example, if tomorrow there is a third mode, let's say network mode. So we'll just add a new mode over here, and the process method of that mode will handle its input and its output. So overall, if you see the difference between the two modes is just, or maybe another mode will be just that how the input will happen, right? Like in most of the cases, input will happen like in the two modes. If you see the difference, the only difference which we can see is like it's just the input, how the input is happening. In file mode, the input is happening via file input, and in interactive mode, the input is happening actually via command line interactive mode, right? So but the actual processing of the commands, actual processing of the each of the command that we get is still the same. Let's say if we get create parking lot, so create parking lot processing will still be the same. It's just that we in the file mode we read it from the file, and in input interactive mode we read it from directly from the command line, right? So this, that's the actual intention over here. So we created common abstract class instead of an interface so that the common behavior of processing a single command can be abstracted out in the top class, and the actual behavior of processing a single type of mode is being delegated to the particular mode. So for example, over here we get a command directly to process, which is being called by the process function. And then after we get the command, where the command we can either get from the file mode or from the interactive mode, we have to process the command, right? I mean, so we get the process command and we just have to process it. How this process command will be called, let's see that, like how the file and interactive mode will be processing, taking the input and converting it into command. So for example, the process method, it's in the file mode actually just extends mode, so it has to implement this process method. So process method will first of all, since it's a file mode, it has to read the file, and then it has to get a file reader. And if the file is not found, then it's the, like basic checks and all we have put, like invalid file we'll just print. And once the file is there, then we'll just start reading file line by line. So we'll read the first line, and until we have something in the file, we'll just keep on reading. And from the file input string that we have received as a single line, we'll create a command out of it, and then we'll ask the common process command method to process the command. So let's see how the commands look like. So command actually looks like this. So it just takes command name and params. So whatever string input that we get, we'll get it as the input in the constructor of the command, and then we will convert that input line into the command object. So how the command object will look like, the first up to first space, it's a command name, and then there are all params. So that's how we have done it. We have tokenized the input or split the input line with a space, and we just consider like the first character or the first string to be the command name, and the rest of the strings are the params. And now it will depend on each of the commands how they want to treat the params. So for example, create parking lot, if you see over here, let's say create parking lot, has one param, so it is an integer, but it will be read as a string into the command object, because command itself doesn't know what's the type of params, what how many params are expected. It just reads the params that are there in the input and the command name. So for example, it will have two params, so that way the command will itself just store the params, right? Then that's command. So we were at file mode. So file mode will read the input from the file, and it will process the command, and then it will ask for the next input, right? So that's how the single processing of a single command works out. Similarly, for the interactive mode, the processing will still be the same. We'll try to convert the input line, we'll try to read line by line from the command line, and then we'll be processing each command one by one by converting it into command, and then processing that command. It's just that there is one special thing which is called exit command. Like if there is an exit which we get from the user, then we'll just handle it separately, because that's not there in the file mode. So we cannot have it common in the mode thing, so we'll have to put it in the interactive mode. So that's the only common thing. So once we get the command out of it, we'll just use the process command to process the command. So for the single command, we'll get a command executor from the command executor factory. And the command executor will first validate whether the command is valid or not. And if the command is valid for that particular command executor, then it will just execute it. And if the command is not valid, then it will throw the invalid command exception. We'll go into details of each command executor, but let me just show you command executor factory. So command executor factory, as you saw, like we are just trying to fetch the command for the particular executor for the particular command. So we take the command as the input, and all the commands that we have already registered into the system. So for example, like command name as status command, leave command, park command, all the commands we have already registered in the system in this factory, and that's how whenever we get any command, we'll just get its executor, right? So that's how we'll get the command. We'll convert the command into a command executor, and then command executor will execute that command. We'll go into detail in some time. Let's go through the model first. Let's see how the model works out. So model has a car, so that's a basic entity in our system. We have to park a car, so we have created a model object for it, model class for it. So car will have a registration number and a color. We have like created two getters also for getting the registration number and the colors, and the car will be instantiated with those two values. Then command we already discussed, like it will have command name and params. Then slot will be having a slot number. It identifies a single slot into the parking lot. It takes a slot number into the input into the constructor, so that it can initialize itself with a particular slot number, and then it also saves the parked car image. So whenever a car is parked into the slot is given that car, so that it can be checked like whether the car is there or not, so that we can check whether the car is slot is free or not, and we can also get the car which is parked in a single slot, right? So it works both ways, like it gives us two things. We can get car from the slot, and also we can check whether the slot is free or not. So and there are two other methods, like assign car and unassigned car. Assigned car will assign the car into the particular slot, and unassigned car will remove the car from its slot, so it will make the slot is free. Okay, so now we have parking lot is again a model object in our design. So parking lot has a capacity is the overall capacity of the parking lot, like how many maximum number of slots it will have. So while creating the parking lot, we'll check like whether the parking capacity is valid or not, whether it exceeds the maximum capacity or whether it should not be less than equals to zero, right? So for basic checking, we have created this, and it will have some slots. So like each parking lot has number of slots. So we are maintaining a map for that, like a map from the slot number to the exact slot object, so that if we want any slot for a specific number, then we will just directly get it from the map. So it's sort of a hash table over here. Then parking lot, when we are initializing a parking lot, it's checking like what's the capacity for it. It's initializing the capacity. If the capacity is invalid, then we are throwing the exception. And we are storing these slots. Initially all the slots are empty, so we have just initialized the slots as empty hash map. Now this is just a helper method to get the slots. Now whenever we want to park a car, so what behavior should a parking lot should give, right? So a parking lot can park a car, or it can make the slot free, right? So park or unpark. So there is a helper method for parking a car. Parking a car will take a car which is going to be parked and a slot number, right? So like park this car in this slot number. Since parking lot itself will not decide where the car should be parked, because you know, like parking lot will be told like we have to park this car in this particular slot. As we saw, like we have to park from like first to in the slot which is nearest to the gate, right? So if there is another way, like instead of taking the parking lot or the slot number directly from the outside, if the parking lot itself generates the parking number, then there is one problem, which is like, you know, if tomorrow the strategy changed, let's say instead of the nearest one, now we have to park from the outside one. I mean the farthest one we have to park first. So let's say instead of starting from one, we have to start from the last slot. Let's say parking slot is six slots. So we'll have to park first in six. Let's say tomorrow's strategy changes to that. So then the whole parking lot class will have to change, right? So to avoid that, parking lot itself does not tell like in which slot I'm gonna park. Instead, it will take a slot number and it will just park the car in that slot number. So slot number will not be generated by the parking lot. Slot number will be generated by something else, which is called parking strategy. Okay, so parking a car, we'll just, you know, get the slot for the slot slot number, and if the slot is not free, then we'll just say through an exception like slot is already occupied, and if the slot is free, that means we'll just assign the car to the slot and the slot becomes full. So that's how we'll park the car. When we are making the slot free, we'll just get the slot for that particular slot number and we'll make it free. Now, while getting the slot in both the functions, we'll just have a helper method locally, which will check whether the slot number is valid or not. If there is an invalid, if the slot number is invalid because it is coming from outside of the class, so the validation has to be done. So if the slot number is invalid, we'll throw an exception. Otherwise, we'll just, you know, get all the slots from the internal method that we have. And if the slots already contains the slot number, that means there's already a slot object created for the slot number, we'll just return it. Otherwise, we'll first create the slot object for the slot number. So we are just doing it lazily. If you want, you can do it. You can, you know, create all the slots at once in the beginning, and then you will not have to do this check. You will just directly use this from this line. So this is a parking lot model. This object is actually defining like a parking lot, which is containing some slots and a capacity. Now, as I told you earlier, like this parking lot itself is not generating the slot numbers. So what we have instead is a parking lot strategy or a parking strategy. So parking strategy will tell you what is the next slot which is going to be used. So for example, the default parking strategy that we have in the question, in the problem, is natural sort, natural ordering, right? Like 1, 2, 3, 4. So there is a default implementation which I have done, which implements parking strategy. Which implements the parking strategy in a way which in the natural ordering which are used for deciding the slot numbers. For example, first car will be parked in slot number 1, then in slot number 2, and then slot number 3, and so on, right? So the parking strategy, if we see what method it's exposes is add slot, remove slot, and get next slot. As you can see, like get next slot is anyways the obvious one. We need to get the next slot in which the car has to be parked. Similarly, we have to add any slot which gets free, or in the beginning, like we have to create all the slots which are there in the parking strategy, and we have to remove the slot from the parking strategy, like whenever a slot gets used up by a parking lot, right? So there are two things right now. One is parking lot and one is parking strategy. Parking lot actually has the actual slots, which is the slot object, which gets occupied once the car gets in there and gets parked in the slot. And strategy only is a logical thing over parking lot, which just maintains like what slots are free, what slots are occupied, so those sort of things. Just to decouple the strategy logic from the parking lot, we have created this extra interface, and that's this object. Now both of these objects are being used by parking lot service. So parking lot service actually integrates into the system and integrates both the parking lot and parking strategy together. So there's a service called parking lot service which we have created. It has two objects, one is parking lot and one is parking lot strategy. During the object initialization in this constructor, it takes these two things, and parking lot service assumes that there is only single parking lot which it manages. So if there is a parking lot already there, then we will just through an exception, otherwise we'll initialize it, and we'll also initialize the parking strategy that we are going to take. So this is sort of, you know, parking lot service sort of a glue between the parking lot and a parking strategy. It's like sort of combining both of them together, right? So once we get this, we'll just get the capacity of the parking lot, like whatever capacity the parking lot is running at, we'll create that many slots at the parking strategy, because parking strategy needs to know how many slots are there so that it can start giving back slots as per that. So for example, if there are 6 slots, it will first of all give 1 for the natural ordering, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, then 6, and once 6 slots are done, then it will throw like there are no slots available. So there's a sync between parking lot and parking strategy. Because of this also, there's a coupling which has happened between parking lot and parking strategy. Like if the capacity of parking lot changes, parking strategy would never come to know. So this is sort of a drawback in this design. I'll come to, you know, drawbacks of further announcements which can be done in this design and towards the end, but I just wanted to highlight this. Then again, parking lot service will also support park method. Assume to be, you know, like parking lot service is running at the gate where the car is coming. So it will have methods like park or unpark, right? Like when the car is moving out, when the car is coming in, it will also tell what are occupied slots are there, what are free slots are there. So whatever methods are required or behaviors are required from the parking lot service, parking lot as a service, then these things are being exposed by this class. So it has like, you know, when the car enters, it has a park method. So park will take a car and it will validate whether parking lot exists or not, because it's a service. It will first have to check whether there is a parking lot initialized or not. If it's not initialized, then it will throw an exception like parking lot does not exist. If the parking lot already exists, then it will get the next free slot from the strategy and ask the parking lot to reserve it. I mean, parking over here, since it's a logical thing, there's no specific car getting parked. So over here, it's like logically sort of parking the car into the slot. And then since the slot has been reserved or slot has been used by the parking lot, so it will just ask the parking strategy to remove the slot from its further usage, right? So, and then once it's done, we'll give the next, the slot which is allotted, and park method will return it. Then once the car is leaving, we'll have to make the slot free. So we'll the car will show that ticket in the slot number, and we'll again initialize, validate first the parking lot should be there, and then we'll make the slot free and also remove it from the parking strategy. Also add it back to the parking strategy, like we'll now have this slot available for the further cars. So this becomes available to the parking strategy too. This was for making a slot free. Then we have a method for getting all the occupied slots, which will give a list of all the slots. So this will get all the slots from the parking lot, and it will have, like, you know, this is a map. So for all the slot numbers, like from one to all the capacity, we'll see if the slots object has a, because it's a map, the slot can be there, cannot be there. So if it's a slot is there, and if it is not free, then we will add it to the occupied slot list and we will return it. So it's just a method implemented to get all the occupied slots, as we have to we have to use it in the commands that we get from the input. We'll come to commands just after this. Then this is helper method, which we already discussed, and for the slots for the color, right? So this helper method I created over here, this could have been created directly in the command where we are using it. So we'll see both of the ways, right? Let's go to the command executor so that we'll understand it better. So what command executor does is, command executor has it takes parking lot service, like it has to execute the commands using the parking lot service, right? So it will take the parking lot service as its input, and it will also output something to the user, right? So it will take output printer. It has two methods it exposes. One is validate and one is execute. So validate method validates whether the current command is valid or not. If the command is valid, then it will return boolean true, otherwise false. And if the command is valid, then you are expected to execute expected to run method execute. So execute method just executes the command which is given. It does not validate, right? So even if the command is invalid and you execute it, then also it will try to execute. It might fail at some point, but you are actually expected to validate the command first. Cool. So now let's see some command. Let's say create parking lot. So it defines its command name, whatever its command name is. So it's create parking lot, and it takes the parking lot service and output printer, as we saw. Now for the validation part, like each of the command, now command executor now has to define these two methods, validate and execute. So each of the command executor will tell like how it want to validate it command. So for example, this command expects a number after this command name, right? So over here we say like command name, when the command is given, the command params should be having size as 1, right? So if the size is not equals to 1, because there should be one number at the end, so we'll return false, and the number should be integer. So if it's not integer, then we'll return false. So that's how we'll validate it. We are not validating the command name over here, because we are expecting that this particular command will be executed only when the command is this. We can have extra assert
check over here to check the command name, whether it is the valid command or not.
Instead of that, actually what I would do is, I will create a method, get name, and it will return the command name, let's say over here, instead of this variable. And now what I will try to do is, instead of doing it at the end, so I will try to do this at a common point. So for example, I will, let's say, I would export a separate method. Now, what I'll do is I'll just see, you know, if command dot get command name equals get name, return false, right? And then return validate. So this will now become a protected method, okay? And this will become a public method, and everyone will now be expected to call command validate. And internally, I am doing this common check over here, like the command name should be correct, and then normal validate, which is provided by each of the command. And each of the command will, I will get the command name from here, right? So that's how I can, this is protected actually. So that's how I can move this out, the common behavior at a top class. I have shown you now how you can extract out common functionalities, because none of the, each of the class otherwise will have to do the same thing, right? So that's how we can do it. I will just revert the changes for now. Okay, so the whole idea is the command executable will first validate the command and then it will execute it. So it is validating over here and then it is executing, and in the executing, like for example, this command is for creation of parking lot. So it will get the, from the params, it will, since we have already validated this, so we already know like the params are correct and the command is valid. So we already know the first param is the number which is validated by the command itself. So we'll just directly get the number and we'll create the parking lot, right? And we'll ask the parking lot service to get the, to assign the parking lot to itself, right? Like create a parking lot for that. And then we'll just print, ask the output printer to print that created a parking lot with the number of slots that we get as the input, that is there, that we have to show the output to the user, right? So that's all we needed to do, and we have done. Let's see some other command. Let's say park command also. So we'll just see, we'll get the, again the park command name is park over here. Again we are validating. So we'll get like size should be 2, and the park command actually take 2 strings, which we anyways get a string. So we will not validate whether the strings are not, because the params itself take list of strings. So we just validate, we'll get 2 inputs. One is the registration number and one is the color. And then while executing, we'll create a new car and we'll see like first param is the registration number and second param is the color. We could have if the time permits, we could have add additional validations over here, like the second param should be a color name. We could have, you know, had some heuristics like white, black. We could have some predefined colors, and you know, we could have checked the color name against those lists. But what if some new color came up? So it's better to, you know, have this thing flexible enough, maybe to not check those against color name. But for the registration number, actually we could have a format, like if I show you like this registration number, they have a format, right? Like 2 characters, then hyphen, 2 numbers, then hyphen, then 2 characters, and then 4 numbers, right? So we could have a regex matching over here, like registration number should be matching to this particular regex. So I just created car with these 2 strings. First is the registration number, there's the color, and then I will just ask the parking lot service to park the car. If there is no slot exception available comes, then I'll just output that parking lot is full. Otherwise, if the parking was successful, then I will just say like what's the allocated number which is given by the parking lot service, right? So parking lot service is handling the parking and all, right? So this command executor is just running through all the commands. Similarly, let's say for the slot for registration number, if we have to get, so again the validation number is just a slot, it's just a registration number. So we'll just see like parking, the command's param size should be 1, and then we'll just execute it. And during the execution, we have first of all we get all the occupied slots, and then we, you know, try to filter like, you know, what's the registration number that we have to find. So we have to filter all this, we have to filter the slot with the given registration number, right? So we'll get first of all the occupied slots, and then we'll take the registration number that we have to find, and then from all the occupied slots we'll try to find slot which has the parked car with the given registration number, right, which we have got. And whatever list we got, we'll just give the first one from there. This is the like functional way of doing things in Java. Then if the slot is present, then I will just return like this is the slot number, otherwise I'll say car is not found, like, because this can be an optional thing. And if this find first, if you see it returns an optional, which means that the slot can be there and can it may not be there with a given registration number, because we can have car in the parking lot and it may be like car is not there park in the parking lot, right? So for that one, because of that, it is an optional, and in the optional thing, we'll first check if the slot is present. If the slot is present, then we'll return the slot number, otherwise we'll do not found. So similarly, other commands are written like we'll have leave command, and then leave command will just make the slot is free. See, whatever the way I have created, like I have only explained you right till now, like the design that I have created, like these are the files, these are the calls, this other thing. But why I have designed it this way, it also has some meaning, like why I created command executor factory, why I created this command executor, why I created mode interface. So these all have some meaning. So the overall idea or the overall intention behind the overall design is that you have to make your design extensible for future. Considering like you do not have to make too much effort into currently, so there is a clear balance which you have to make while designing your system, while designing the low level design of a system. Like you have to make sure that whenever you can create extensible things, you should create extensible things, scalable things. Like say, considering if something comes in future, then also you should be able to incorporate them without making very much of changes. So that's the whole solid principles and design principles come into picture. All the design principles, if you learn, they all try to make your design such that if there is something new coming up in the future, there will only be number of additions into the code and there will be very less amount of changes in the existing files. That's the whole goal of designing a good system. Why? Because if you try to change so many files into the existing system, then what will happen is you will start creating bugs into the existing system. It will start creating some regressions, something existing will start breaking. So the whole goal of the system design is like you should design your system in such a way that whenever something new comes up in future, you should not be changing the existing files, only the new files need to be added. So that's the whole goal also I took while designing this. So for example, while creating commands, I could have also done it like creating a single command executor. Like this, instead of this interface, I could have created a single class, and this single class could have like if condition, if the command is this, then execute, then do this. If the command is this, then do this. So that way I could have done. But what could have happened over there is, even if adding a new command over there, then also I would be changing a file which is handling the existing command. So for example, if I let's say add a new command to let's say close parking lot, right? We have create parking lot command. Let's say tomorrow we have close parking lot also. So for close parking lot, though it has nothing to do with park command, slot for registration command, no other commands it has association with, then also it will be changing the file which is handling those existing commands, right? And since you will be changing the file which will be handling those existing commands, so there are high chances that you will create some regression or some bugs into the existing commands also, even though the change was not at all related to that. So it will be better if we can just add something instead of changing something, right? So using this design, what will happen is if you create a new command over here, you will just create a new file for that command and implement it with this abstract class or conform to this abstract class, and then plug it into this factory. This is a single line which you will just plug it, like I'm registering this command for this command executor. So this registration will happen and only a new file will be added. No other changes will be done, right? No existing files, no existing commands will see any change. So this is the whole idea, like you will not be editing existing files, you will just be adding a new file and registering it with the factory. Similarly for the modes, like the mode, we have a common method which is for process command. So we have got the process command as common method in the mode. Only the way the input is being done is done separately. So we have done over here. So if there's a new mode tomorrow for the network mode, it can just extend the mode again and it will read from the network and use the process command to process the commands at the other modes are doing. So it will not have to edit or change or even touch the file modes or interactive modes, right? And in case of new mode, we not even have to change the mode file also, we just have to plug it into the main function. Now this is not a good thing over here. We could have a factory defined for converting a mode from the argument. So this is an improvement sort of thing that we can do. Similarly, for the parking thing, if I could have done over here only, like, you know, instead of getting the slot number, I could have generate the slot number right and then and there. I could have kept and stayed in the parking lot, like what is the next slot to be given, and I could have just used that strategy to that way to get the slot number. But that would have you know, made this parking lot very coupled to that natural ordering parking strategy. So if tomorrow, let's say, there's a new parking lot which is coming up and we have a new requirement, like a parking lot should have even odd strategy, let's say first of all the even will have to be filled and then odd will have to be filled, so this parking lot class will have to be changed and there will be, like, you know, bugs will be introduced and when many issues will be there. So instead of that, I decided to create a parking strategy, and that can define, like, what's the next slot to be given. So tomorrow, if we have odd even strategy, so we'll just confirm that strategy to the parking strategy and it's really start working. We just had to, you know, plug it while creating the parking lot. So parking lot service, actually. So while creating the parking lot service, we'll just get the parking strategy, and whenever creating the parking lot, we'll just define the parking strategy, like even and odd. So tomorrow, if we get parking strategy also as a command input, then we'll just plug it from outside while creating a new parking strategy and implementing it to the parking strategy, right? So this also becomes extensible and scalable in a sense that no, very few changes will be needed. Most of the changes will be only additions. Only few modifications into the existing classes will be needed, right? So that's how I implemented parking strategy. Then there were some model classes, that's fine. Parking slot service is again there for general thing, right? So overall way, if you see, like, I have tried to design the system by dividing system into various pieces and then combining those pieces together so that overall system works. That's called actually composition. Whenever you design a system, try to think in terms of a composition design principle. Just read about it. It's a very strong principle while designing a system. It helps you a lot in designing scalable and future proof systems. In the same way, like, you will have to make very less amount of changes, only additions will be there when you use compositions. So composition along with inheritance is a very, you know, very good, very strong design which comes up when you use these two principles together. So that's pretty much it in the terms of actual system. Then we have some tests. So that's, I think, anyways there. So you can just go through them anytime you want. I have actually pushed this code into the repository. So I will give the link of that repository, of the GitHub repository, in the description. You will find it in the description and you can just check out this code and, you know, play around with it. Now I want to discuss one more thing, which is the, you know, some of the future enhancements of other enhancements that I thought can be there. So for example, over here, let's see, these are the further enhancements that I think can be there. So for example, dependency injection. Right now I'm doing all the dependency injection manually. So for example, when I'm creating this command executor, so parking lot service is injected manually. When I create parking lot service, then also the things are injected manually. So for example, here, like, parking lot and natural parking strategy is injected manually. So we could have used some dependency injection framework, for example, a Spring or something, which could have prevented us from doing these manual injections. Exit command again is, you know, it's sort of a hard-coded thing into the interactive mode, so we could have avoided that. We could have actually, you know, moved the exit command behavior also into the exit command executor. Right now exit command executor does not do anything, it just prints that I'm exiting. Instead of here, we could have, you know, like, just exit from the process, like, we could have killed the process from the process itself. So that could have been one way instead of having a hard check in this particular area. So because command is still a command, right? Exit command becomes unusable for different things. For example, for the network mode, exit command become unusable, right? So we could have used we could have exited from the process, that it, then the exit command will become reusable for all the modes wherever exit has to be happened from the process. So that's again one improvement I can see. Another improvement is parking strategies right now associated with parking dot service. So if you see, the parking dot service is having the parking lot parking strategy, but actual, if you, you know, think, then parking lot strategy is actually a concept of parking lot, right? So tomorrow, if we have, let's say, multiple parking lots, let's say parking lot service is handling up multiple parking lots, then what will happen is we'll having multiple parking lots coming in and multiple parking strategies coming in, and then we will have to keep track, like, okay, same indexes, parking strategies map to same parking lots, right? So instead, if we could have, we should have actually associated parking lot strategy with the parking lot, and parking lot service should have only taken the parking lot as the input, and then parking lot in itself will be handling the parking lot strategy as well as parking lot slots. I'm not saying parking lots should itself handle the parking lot strategy implementation, like the parking lot strategy should be separate as it is right now. It's just that the object or the composition that we are doing at the parking lot service level, that should have been done at the parking lot level, because so that whenever we have multiple parking lots, each of the parking lot will have its own parking strategy, and these parking strategy can be switched using this interface, right? So that's again one improvement. Mode, as I already told you, like, you know, main function will be changed whenever the new mode is introduced, which is not at all intended. You don't have to change the main function, right? You have to change the classes or add new classes related to the mode. So, but over here, the main function will be changed when new mode is added. So we can have a factory for mode creation. Cool. So that's actually pretty much it. In the readme, I've also mentioned like how you can run the project, what are the requirements. You will file everything into the repo. So this is the repo which I have already posted to GitHub. You will see everything over here, like whether it's how to run, how to, what the further announcement, like everything I have in the local thing I have put it in the repo. I'll just give the link of this repo in the description, and yeah, that's pretty much it. Thanks for watching. Thanks a lot, and you know, do give your comments in the feedback. I'll see you soon in the next video. Bye bye.